thank you all for having me here today. It's really cool to be here. This is a great venue. I would like it if we could maybe find a way to put the little wedding reception lights on up there on the ceiling. That would be kind of sweet, but you know, we'll work with it. This is excellent. I am Kelly Milligan, Dallas Area Council for Chicago Title Corporate Direct. Very pleased to have the opportunity to talk to you about what we've got coming in the year ahead. Now, I've been doing the economic update for the CCAR meetings really for most of the last 7 or 8 years. And for those of you that have been through them, you know that it tends to follow a pattern. I get up, I start riffing on what a bunch of knuckleheads we have in charge of the economy, and then we start talking about the real estate market. I like to do things a little differently where I can. And so in an effort to give you a little something different, we've come up with a new metric to kind of measure the relative state of affairs with the Dallas-Fort Worth real estate market. How many of you have been in the business longer than 10 years? Okay, then all of you, or at least most of you anyway, are gonna understand exactly what I'm talking about. I think a good way to determine where our market is going and where it's heading is to do nothing more than look at the musings of our own, the Steve Brownometer. All you have to do if you want to get a sense of where our housing market is headed is take a look at what you get from Dallas Morning News real estate writer Steve Brown. Now, everybody in here that's been in the business a while remembers 2006, previous top of the market, right? It looked like everything we touched was turning to gold and things could do nothing but move upward. Then in 2007, we had a little bit of an interruption in the middle of the year. Market cooled somewhat. We still had a pretty good year. And during that period, Steve Brown was not exactly outright negative. It was just sort of this air of menace in his columns. Yeah, okay, things are going fine, but just you wait. It's not gonna last forever. By the time we got to 2008, Steve was able to just let his negativity run gleefully. The end is near. If you were selling real estate, his suggestion was that you go get a tin cup and sell produce on a corner somewhere in downtown. 2009 and 2010, when the market really bottomed out, he took on the mien of a villain in a Scooby-Doo cartoon. All of you, you're doomed. 2011, repeat, I'm telling you. Although that was the year that you will remember things started on their upward trajectory. We finally started to see the first stirrings of a comeback in our market in 2011. 2012 is when this business started to get fun again. We finally saw an actual increase in transaction volume, and the lights went down, but we still don't have the wedding light. Okay, at any rate. But by 2012, Steve wasn't able to find as much wrong with the market because it looked like things were heading in the right direction. In 2013 and 14, we had two back-to-back years that looked like the best year in the history of our market. We didn't have as many sales as what we had in 2006, but in terms of dollar volume, we were eclipsing the previous high of the market. We had gotten back the value that we lost in the correction, and we were really gaining steam. And this was sort of tough for Steve because he really couldn't find a whole lot negative to say about our real estate market. 2015, he had to acknowledge that we were now living in the best of all possible worlds in terms of Dallas-Fort Worth real estate, the best market we've ever seen. Now, things started to shift a little last year. At the beginning of last year, Steve was busy worrying about some folks up in New England, these hedge fund types who were telling us all that real estate in Dallas was overvalued. And y'all remember why our real estate was overvalued? Because of the energy industry? You know how low oil prices were gonna destroy our housing market? How'd that work out, New England analysts? Yeah, thank you. And this year, Steve has come full circle. On December 28th, he ran a series of projections for the market. And one of the things he said, I'm quoting him directly, "For the second year in a row, my biggest worry is the white hot Dallas housing market." So what this means, does it mean we're at the end of times? No, but Steve is finding things to worry about again. So obviously it's something that we need to keep our radar on. That said, what are we gonna get next year? As I now drop my glasses, this is just an absolute Charlie Foxtrot. There we go. Before we get into what the market's gonna do this year, let's review what we projected for 2016. The first thing, most of us were saying that we thought transaction volume would be flat or if up just slightly. And the reason that we didn't think we were gonna see a big increase in transaction volume obviously was inventory. Nobody wanted to sell houses last year either. And we started hearing for the first time all the talk about how the price increases were now making this market less affordable for a lot of home buyers. So most people in our industry were projecting that sales would be flat. If up at all, it would be very slight. We knew that we would see an increase in dollar volume. That was a pretty safe bet. We've had now 4 years in a row of near double-digit price increases. We knew that we would see more price increases last year, so pretty much everybody was saying we'd make more money as an industry. And if you think about it, that's really what matters to us. We can talk about the number of homes sold, but our 3% is based on the sale price. So if those prices are going up, that's good for all of us in the room. It wasn't going too far out on a limb. We knew that number would be better. The question is how much prices would increase. Here's where the experts kind of got it wrong. You had a lot of people. Dr. Gaines down at the Real Estate Center at A&M thought price appreciation would cool. Jonathan Smoke, who's the head realtor, or the head economist rather, at realtor.com, was saying that prices would only increase 4 to 6%. And the reason he said this would happen is because we were gonna get this huge glut of listings in the middle of the year. Do you guys remember the huge glut of listings from the middle of the year? Yeah, me either. The Great Pumpkin hasn't shown up either. And because of the low oil prices, that would wreck our demand factor because the whole market would go badly. And, you know, there would be magical dancing unicorns leading the big parade through downtown Dallas. And basically, that was where we went. I should mention, by the way, and I did mention this in Plano last week, the unicorn clip art was selected by my media-savvy 12-year-old daughter, Mary Kate. She chose it because, in her judgment, it was the optimal mix of undeniable cuteness and total cheesiness. And so there you have Mary Kate's unicorn selection. But the bottom line, flat transaction volume, more money getting made, price appreciation stalling in that 4 to 7% range. So what wound up happening last year? A lot of people were right about some things, and a lot of people were wrong about things. And the bottom line is, once again, we pretty much just totally rocked it in 2016. Let's take a look at the numbers. The first thing I would mention, when you do this speech in January, the hazard is you don't always have final NETRIS data. As I stand here today, we have almost all of it, but there are some numbers that we haven't yet been able to get our hands on. So we're working with what we've got for final data. We're also working with a few projections, and where that's the case, I will let you know. But bottom line, working with what we've got, we know that it was another record year for our market. Here are a few things to consider. First off, the total value of all residential real estate in the Dallas-Fort Worth Metroplex, now $457 billion. That's a staggering number if you stop and think about it. That is like more than the gross domestic product of most South American nations, individually or combined. It's also up 11.1% from last year. So what that tells you is not only are we working with and in a milieu of a lot of wealth, it gets better every year. The second thing that we know is that Freddie Mac, the mortgage institution, now ranks Dallas as the number one housing market in the United States. This article came out toward the end of last year, around the 28th or 29th. It was in the Dallas Morning News. The methodology was a little bit fuzzy. You had to read it to kind of figure out where they got this designation. But as nearly as we can tell, what they're doing is looking at how the biggest markets in the country have performed since the correction in 2007 and 8, and they combine that with how much room there is for further upward growth. Based on the way that we have gotten value back, exceeded our previous value, and the fact that we've still got room for prices to increase before things become a problem, Freddie Mac says you are working as realtors in the best housing market in the United States. It's certainly better than being a realtor in, say, Scranton, Pennsylvania, right? Okay? So those are a couple of things we know. The third thing we know, total sales in the Metroplex last year set a new record. We were wondering if we might break 100,000. 94,000 was the number in 2015, if you will remember. Well, last year we topped the 101,000 sale mark. We did that with a phenomenally strong November and December. We'll talk about that more later. Total dollar volume, using what we have through November, and then making some projections based on December pendings and sales, it looks like our final number here is going to be in the vicinity of $28.2 billion, but it's certainly going to eclipse the $28 billion mark. So however you want to slice it, those are some pretty good numbers, great things for the health of our market. But yet wait, there is more. Okay, the price appreciation. 4 to 6%, Jonathan Smoke was a little bit low. Anybody know what price appreciation did last year? About 10%. So for those of you projecting 4 to 6%, sorry, you're wrong. Here's your Rice-A-Roni. Thank you for playing. The market rocked pretty much all the way around. But beyond that, let's take a look at it on a by-county basis. Dallas County projected sales by year's end, we should have 24,400 or so, basically flat from 2015. Projected dollar volume, though, $7.85 billion. That's almost a 10% increase over 2015. Here in good old Collin County, projected sales not up that much over 2015, probably just under 16,000, maybe a 1.5% increase over 2015, but the projected dollar volume of $5.64 billion is a 13% increase over what we saw in 2015. So Collin County realtors made good money last year. Denton County has been one of the hottest areas in North Texas for the last several years. Who wants to tell me why? Why are things so hot in Denton County right now? It's one of the few places in North Texas where you can find affordable homes for first-time home buyers and for families looking to trade up. While the market gets pricey elsewhere, there are still affordable homes in Denton County. And as a result, a lot of the action has moved to places like Little Elm, Frisco, that 380 corridor. So a lot of activity in Denton County. Their projected sales, just under 15,000, which is a 6% increase. Projected dollar volume, a 15% jump over 2015. So every county you look at, we got good things to talk about. I mentioned earlier, we had a strong finish to the year. In November, sales on a year-over-year basis were 26% higher than they were in November of 2015. We'd never seen a month like that in November. I mean, you have busy months in July. November felt like July for a lot of us. It was that busy, and the final numbers bear that out. December, 8% better than 2015. So another strong finish got us over the line and got us to new record status. For the fourth year in a row, we can say that we had the best year in the history of our market. So let's take a little bit more into the numbers here. Let's dig a little further. The first thing, median sale price for the Netris region, now at about $232,000. That is a 10% increase over 2015, a bit higher than the experts were predicting at the beginning of 2016. Median sale price in Dallas County, about $218,500. That is an 18% increase. This is using November numbers. They may look different when we finally get December, but when you look at November over November, Dallas County up 18%, Collin County up nearly 11%, Denton County up 8%. So prices continue to appreciate. Your average sale price, another useful measure, up in Dallas County by nearly 17% on a year-over-year basis. Collin County up 12.3, Denton County up 6.3. So however you want to measure it, dollar volume, transaction volume, your median sale price, or your average sale price, pretty good year. I'll use something of a visual aid here. Can you all kind of see the paper I've got in my hand? In the back, you're just seeing a lot of color probably, am I right? When I crunch the numbers for the Netris reporting zone and I type them out, if it's a positive number, you get a little yellow spot. If it's a double-digit positive, you get kind of a weird blue. Above that, you get purple. Look at all the color there. When we did this in, say, 2008, it was a white sheet. There was no good news to be had. Now, every area of the market, we're seeing some measure of improvement. And what you'll notice when you look at the data, as we're about to do, is there will be some areas where sales were off or flat, but where that was the case, you still saw price increases. Housing prices in Dallas-Fort Worth today, now 40% higher than they were at the previous peak in 2007. A lot of times when we trot out these numbers, we like to tell you how much better off we are than we were at the low point in 2009. That's not fun anymore. I mean, because the bottom line is we're about 50% over that. We got back our value after the correction faster than any other market in the country, and we now stand 40% better than we were before the correction at the previous peak in 2007. And prices have risen, as we note, 40% in the last 4 years. So what you think? Good place to be realtors here? Yeah? Yeah? Okay, good. All right. Let's take a look at the charts. You can find these on the website for the Real Estate Center at Texas A&M. This is just year-over-year comparisons between 2014, 15, and 16. And if you look at the chart for the Metroplex, you're going to see that with the exception of July, pretty much every month, 2016 did better than one or both of the previous years. July of 2015 was like the perfect storm. That will go down as one of the busiest, craziest months in the history of our market. We'll still be talking about that in a few years, a sign that we probably don't have enough to talk about. But the bottom line, 2016, every month of the year, with the exception of July, better for the Metroplex as a whole. If you look at Dallas County, you will see the same dynamic, and you'll note a very strong November there. You see that black bar on the chart. Collin County, same thing. There were a few months that maybe were off a little bit, but by and large, a very solid performance in 2016. Denton County, month over month, year over year, the market did better. And here is where we get a lot of those sales that are reflected in the final numbers. We don't talk much about Tarrant County, and a lot of us probably don't do too terribly much over there, but it was a very strong year for our friends to the west, and all of that is reflected in the final numbers that make this the hottest market that you're going to find anywhere in the country. Breaking down the specific NETRIS data, looking at it by particular areas, you can see kind of what I was referencing. The green numbers show you an increase. The purple and blue numbers show you big increases. Allen, for example, not a good year in terms of sales or dollar volume. Should we conclude from that that Allen is no longer a hot or desirable market? Of course not. The reason sales were down is what? Nobody wants to sell a home in Allen, and so as a result, fewer homes were sold in Allen. But look at the price measure. The median sale price went up 3.5%, and if you want to look at the average sale price in Allen, that went up by a pretty good clip as well. That number was, let me put my glasses back on, I hate this aging process, a 3.9% increase. So Allen, very good year, even though sales were off. Take a look at Salina, 33.2% increase in dollar volume. We are now solidly a resale market in Salina. And I would note that in years past, we'd see big dollar numbers in Salina. We'd see big price appreciation numbers, but it was based on a smaller number of transactions. As that corridor of Collin County grows, you got a real legitimate market there. The Colony is one of the markets that has really benefited from the lack of inventory elsewhere. Young families that we used to look in Plano or Carrollton or Louisville, Allen, Richardson, they can't find anything there. They looked in Wiley, they ate up all the inventory. They can't find anything there. So they've gone to the Colony, and as a result, the Colony has had two pretty darn good years back to back, 7% increase in transactions, over 25% in dollar volume. And you can see all the way on down the line, Frisco, now a very solid resale market, 4% increase in transactions, nearly 11% in dollar volume, 7% in price appreciation. Denton, reflected near the bottom here, again, just further indication of the fact that we don't have a lot of inventory in the Metroplex proper. People are now going that far north because they can find affordable housing there. Looking at your second page, Garland, very good year for the Garland market. People are moving in. You got a lot of investors buying in Garland, a lot of rehab business, but it has really helped that market out. And all on down the line, Murphy, Plano, Prosper, Richardson, all had pretty good years. And again, sales might be off or flat in a number of those areas, but if you had the listing and you priced it right, it was going to go and go quickly. And then Wiley here at the bottom is kind of getting cut off. After two really good years, you'll see that the number of sales is down by 15% because now there's nothing left in Wiley. If you look at the path of younger, lower price point home buyers, the first time buyers, the families that are trading up, it's almost like locusts. They go where the inventory is, they buzz through it, and then on to the next spot. So 2 years ago, Wiley was a really hot market, still a very good market. There's just not a whole lot left there. So however you want to look at it, whatever region you want to look at, you can see prices went up just about everywhere. Great year for our market. Foreign buyers, big player in Texas real estate. $10 billion in transactions closed by foreign national buyers this last year. That puts us third behind California and Florida. But nonetheless, with a lot of them paying cash, that was a really great thing for our market. Most of them coming from China. Canada is number two. But we've got people coming from all over the planet to buy property in North Texas. That was a real big boost for our market in 2016. The luxury market, worth talking about. We may not all of us in this room sell a lot of homes priced at over $1 million, but it helps to know what that sector of the market is doing. The reason being, if the luxury segment is moving, that speaks well to the rest of the market. If high net worth individuals are comfortable and confident pumping money into real estate, if they can get loans when they need it, there's liquidity to finance those purchases, that speaks well to the health of the rest of the market. It is kind of trickle down in that sense. Bottom line, for the last 4 years, we have seen remarkable increases in the sales of homes priced at over $1 million. In 2013, that segment grew 23% year over year. In 2014, it was a 16% increase. 12% in 2015. Last year, it was up only 8%. But after 3 years of double digits, you're still talking about some pretty significant increases. We were over 1,100 homes in the $1 million plus range sold. And again, when you look at what that means to the rest of the market, that's a positive indicator. Builders, again, had their best year since the recession. They were hoping they would hit 30,000 starts for the year. They didn't quite get there. They ended up at about 29,600, but they continue to claw their way back. They're still, though, about 40% below where they were at the previous correction. The biggest reason there is that they just don't have the labor. And we're going to talk about that a little later on. But builders are certainly doing what they can to bring about a further comeback in our market. And we got to talk a little bit about apartment construction. This was the busiest year in Metroplex history in the apartment sector. We leased 27,000 new units last year. The previous high was 19,000 back in the 1980s. So last year was number one by a factor of about 8,000. We will have 50,000 units under construction this year, and rents rose on average about 4% last year. But again, that's an average. In certain areas, the rents went up way more than 4%. Let's say, for example, you live or want to live south of 635. You're looking for an apartment because you can't find a home that you can afford. So you're looking at a mature, well-maintained complex in a safe part of Dallas. You think you're going to get a 4% rent increase there? No, you're going to be looking at double digits there. On the flip side, if you come north to Collin County, where you can't swing a dead tuna without hitting a new apartment complex being built, rents aren't going up quite as much. You will see rents closer to a 2 to 4% increase there. Bottom line, we don't always pay as much attention to apartments as we should, but we need to in this market. Apartment dwellers of today are different than the apartment dwellers 10, 15 years ago. 10, 15 years ago, people living in apartments were usually the kids that had just gotten out of college. Their furniture consisted of a futon, a stereo system, perhaps some tobacco accessories, and a pet ferret. Now, the people living in apartments are the Californians that came here last year or 2 years ago, couldn't find a home, so they just got their way into an apartment. And believe me, they are chomping at the bit to get out of that apartment. Even with more of them built, the apartment sector could be fertile hunting ground if you tend to work with buyers. So a lot of great stuff in the market. There's always, though, a little bit of bad news. Last year, there were only one problem that we really needed to talk about. This year, we've got two. The first problem is the one that we've all heard about for several years, that inventory is really bad. How bad is the inventory, Kelly? You may be asking yourself. How bad is the inventory? Well, it's worse than bad. It's really awful. In fact, it's worse than a Katherine Heigl film festival on the Lifetime TV network. And there she is now. That's her last paying role, I believe. Bottom line, inventory is now holding at 16,400 listings for the whole Netris area. That is less than a 2 month supply, and it's down by at least a percentage point over where we were last year when we were saying that inventories were as bad as they had ever been. Dallas County, we're looking at about 4,400 listings. Collin County, we're actually up to 2.2 months, nearly 3,000 listings. Denton County, under 2,500. But here's the thing. We can talk about the number of months of inventory, but we all understand the game. When you break it down by price point, the picture becomes a good deal more dreadful, just these numbers would show you. It skews according to price point. If we want to talk about 750,000, is there inventory there? Yeah. Now, who knows? What do we define as an inventory or a market at equilibrium? How many months?
Six.
Well, just for fun, does anybody know the last time we had 6 months inventory in Collin County? I think Ronald Reagan had a memory then. It goes back an awfully long way. We are literally seriously talking around 07, 08. It has been a long time since we had a market at equilibrium in Collin County. We've been in that 2 month range for an awfully long time. But if we talk about specific price points, it's far more bleak than that. Anybody seen anything in Plano for under $250,000 lately? Well, if you did, it's gone now. Let's put it that way. We can time the market not with weeks or months, but with a stopwatch if we're talking about the sweet spot, which is essentially anything below 500,000. The busiest segment of the market last year, 350 to 600, and in a lot of the areas that we work in and serve, if you can find anything, it's gone before you've even got a chance to put in an offer. That much anticipated flood of listings has not happened, and as of press time, I don't think anyone expects that it's going to. The second problem is affordability. This year, we hear everybody complaining that with all of the price appreciation that we've seen in our marketplace, we've now become too expensive for a lot of home buyers. And undeniably, that is true at certain price points in certain markets. We've already talked about the dynamic. What you could get in Plano 20 years ago can't be found. So we've moved on to Louisville or Carrollton or Wiley or the Colony or now Little Elm. In certain parts of the Metroplex, certain kinds of buyers are having a much more difficult time. But you have to keep in mind that it's all relative. Even with all the price appreciation that we've seen, we remain one of the more affordable housing markets in the country. And indeed, we hear this from corporate executives when they explain why they're moving their business from California or Michigan or wherever to the Metroplex. There are a lot of advantages to being here, but affordable housing, which promotes affordable, stable families and communities, that's definitely one of the big selling points. A good way to look at it is with some data that was found in the Dallas Morning News third, fourth quarter last year sometime. There's an organization called HSH.com that does a study and determines what kind of household income you need to buy the median sale priced home in each of the largest markets in the United States. The national average, $52,000 a year is what you would need to buy the median sale priced home. Here in Dallas, we're still only a little bit above that. You'd need to earn $55,000 a year to get that median sale priced home, which as we know from the slide earlier is around $230,000. Let's compare that to San Francisco. To get the median sale priced home there, you'd need to make $162,000 a year. And what do you suppose that median sale priced home in San Francisco looks like? Probably kind of like the commune that my mom lived in briefly in 1967 herself. Hippie squalor. If you want something in San Francisco that you really love, you've got to earn considerably more than $162,000 a year. And my mother does not mind me pointing out that she used to be a hippie, as she says she's gotten better. So there you go. Another measure of the affordability of our market can be found by going to the Real Estate Center at A&M's website. There's an article by two gentlemen named Torres and Day that measures personal income per capita relative to the appreciation in housing prices. And what Torres and Day have concluded is when you look at the triangle metros, the big four, Dallas, Houston, Austin, San Antonio, housing prices, even though they have appreciated rapidly, are still not outstripping personal income per capita. So they're growing and growing quickly, but so is income for most Texans. A lot of the jobs that we're creating in the state are good jobs, and it gives a lot of Texans still an edge where affordability is concerned. There are people who are losing out. We don't want to lose sight of that, but for the most part, this market is still very affordable. Rising interest rates are where you need to be concerned. Now we know that in the last 2 months, interest rates have gone up about a point. If you were looking at a 30-year fixed in November, you were probably going to get it for around 3 1/8, 3 1/4. Today, you're looking at 4 1/8, 4 1/4, and that can make a difference in terms of your payment. If you're looking at a $350,000 house, that's about a $200 a month increase in your payment. If you're using a 15-year fixed, it's still about a $100 increase. So to me, I think when we worry about affordability, it's not so much that the prices are increasing, it's the fact that we're not going to have a lot of free money anymore. So what you might do is use that to nudge your buyers that are sitting on the fence. If they're thinking maybe they want to wait, I would suggest the contrary. It's not going to get any cheaper to play poker. But still, as a relative measure compared to the other markets, we're still very affordable. So let's talk about 2017. What are we going to be looking at? What are we going to be looking for? First, let's talk a little bit about the national economic outlook. In the past, this has always been the dark cloud. When I've gotten up to talk about what we could expect out of the market, I've usually used this as a disclaimer. Temper your enthusiasm. The reason being, at any moment, the people in Washington could do something to completely screw things up for all of us. I don't feel quite like that this year. The reason being is that the election does signal a change in economic policy. The last administration basically tried to stimulate demand by keeping interest rates low. If it was cheap to borrow money, businesses would borrow money and then put that money out into the economy. That was how they wanted to trigger spending, and it didn't really work too terribly well. If you look at GDP growth for our economy for most of the last 8 years, it was not real robust. We were lucky if we saw economic growth higher than 2%. There was usually this little tango dance we would do. At the end of the quarter, the Department of Labor or the Treasury would release their statistics telling us that we had about a 4% increase in economic growth. And since that's so much higher than what we were used to seeing, we would all do the Snoopy dance and go out for waffles and feel like things were on the right track. Then a month later, when we weren't paying attention because we were watching the Kardashians or something, they would revise the numbers downward, telling us that, oh no, it was actually more like 2%. And then frequently, we'd get a second revision where the numbers would be in that 1.2% range. So bottom line, for most of the last 8 years, our economy has been growing with the potency of a septuagenarian alcoholic at 4 a.m. Things are going to be a little bit different. One thing we know, interest rates are going to go up. The federal funds rate in December went up from 0.38, 38 basis points, to 62. And the world didn't end. Did you guys notice that? See, here's the thing. For most of the last 8 years, anytime a member of the Federal Reserve Board or the Open Market Committee hinted at an increase in the federal funds rate, what did the stock market do? It tanked because investors panicked, and investors panicked because they understood that the economic type people in this administration didn't have any tricks up their sleeve other than free money. When the federal funds rate went up in December, what did the stock market do? It rocked. Good end of the year for a lot of our 401k. So the bottom line, the investors and much of the financial sector understands that we've got some different people running the game. They like what they're seeing. That doesn't mean they're going to agree with everything, and it doesn't mean everything they do is going to work, but the initial signals are promising. Not only will we have higher interest rates, but most people believe we will have much higher GDP growth. By the end of 2017, the economy ought to be growing at a 2.5 to 3% rate, that coming courtesy of the Wall Street Journal survey of economists, and I've seen similar numbers from a lot of other sources. Job creation and wage growth look to be slightly better, although in all fairness, real wage growth in the United States was as solid in 2016 as it has been going back to the 1980s. So that's one thing that the current administration got right. What jobs they created tended to be very good paying jobs, and that helped spur real wage growth for a lot of Americans anyway. Consumer confidence. This is a number we don't pay attention to very often, but we need to. It matters. You got to take a look at consumer sentiment if you want a feel for what the housing market is going to do. The consumer sentiment in this country has been strong since August. People were feeling generally positive about the direction of the economy. It's measured on a number that has a scale kind of like the new SAT tests. We hear the number, but we don't really know what it means, right? So the consumer confidence number in August was at 101. In November, it had gone up to 109, and in December, it had gone up to just under 112. So the bottom line, consumers in America feel much better about the immediate short term, and they feel better about the future of the labor market in this country. When consumers feel better about the economy, are they more or less likely to do something crazy like go buy a house? Exactly. So we like the fact that consumers are feeling better about the direction of the economy. I think that's one of those things that bodes well for us in the year ahead. Bottom line, normally we don't have to give much thought to the national economy because we're in Texas. In the past few years, we've had to kind of keep an eye over our shoulder because we just don't ever know what Washington's going to do. This year, whatever Washington does, I don't think it's going to be anything that will be sufficient to wreck the party, but, you know, talk to me in 6 months and see if I was wrong. Because here in Texas, we've got a lot of good things to talk about. The first is this: we continue to lead the nation in new residents. More people come to the Metroplex every year, every month, than any other part of the country. If we take a look at in-migration, you will see that we've got people moving to the Metroplex at a rate of better than 20,000 new residents in each of the four counties, Dallas, Collin, Denton, Tarrant, every year. It works out to just about 200 new residents a day for the Metroplex coming here from elsewhere. So we lead in in-migration. What does that mean over the long haul? The organizations that chart population growth are saying that we will be at about 7.8 residents total in the Metroplex today. By 2013, we believe that number will be around, or 2030 rather, we believe that number is going to be closer to 9.8 million, and by 2040, we're going to be looking at over 11 million people living in the Metroplex. If you think the lines are bad at In-N-Out Burger now, just talk to me in a few years. Job creation, we'll talk about that in a minute, but when we talk about shifting population, there's another dynamic that I think we need to focus on because this really doesn't get talked about a lot. We know that people are coming here from California and Florida and Illinois, but what we don't always appreciate is that within the North Texas region, people are moving around in different directions. This is taken from some research that ran in the Dallas Morning News. They point out, for example, that between 2010 and 2014, Dallas County received something in the vicinity of 3,000 new residents from Los Angeles and Chicago. But during that same period, 2010 to 2014, they lost close to 8,000 residents to Denton County and 6,000 to Tarrant County. So people come into one county from out of state, people in that county disperse to other areas. What that says to you as realtors is that there is opportunity if you're paying attention to the dynamic. If you're a listing agent in Dallas County, you're gonna find listings because there will be people who wanna put their homes on the market. On the other hand, if you're in Tarrant County and Denton County, you might wanna think about representing buyers because you've got a pretty good stream of them coming from just to the south or just to the east, as the case may be. But the migration within our region is something that we need to kind of pay attention to. Then finally, job creation. Last year, we put about 124,000 new jobs into the labor force. The estimates this year are all over the place. I've seen as low as 120. I've also seen 147,000 from Jonathan Smoke. I hope he's right about this one. But bottom line, that many new jobs means more people moving to the Metroplex. It accelerates the population growth that we've seen. The energy industry. This was sort of the wild card. A lot of people who aren't from Texas and don't understand our regional economy were saying that low oil prices were going to kill the forward momentum of the North Texas economy. A lot of these, though, are people who don't know any more about the Metroplex than what they learned watching Dallas reruns on Nickelodeon. We're not an energy town. We don't have nearly the number of energy jobs in Dallas-Fort Worth as they do in Houston, Austin, or certainly in the Permian Basin. So when oil was scuffling along at $20 a barrel last year, it really wasn't hurting us. We never had that many jobs in the Metroplex dependent on oil and gas production. Well, now let's look at where we are a year later. How's the oil industry looking to you today? Much better. We're now stabilized at around $50 a barrel. Some days we've been up over 53. But the bottom line, the shale producers and the Texas oil and gas producers took OPEC's punch. OPEC seems to have recognized that they're not going to be able to kill the Texas energy industry, so you see OPEC nations instituting production controls. As a result, the prices have stabilized and they're rapidly, well, gradually probably, climbing back up. But in the meantime, we get the best of all worlds. With oil in the 50s, we don't suffer any economic ill effects from low oil prices, but we do get $2.20 at the pump. And that's a positive thing because that gives us more money to spend on margaritas or houses or whatever else we want. So the energy industry, potential danger signal last year, really not hurting us. Another big positive is the millennials. I talked last year about how millennials were set to become the most active segment of the home buying population. By September, that had pretty much proven to be true. Almost 50% of the homes put under contract in September were bought by people who fall into the category of millennials. For that reason, I am no longer going to make fun of millennials. They are now a very positive force in our housing market. And, you know, they're not just spending their money on trucker hats and multiple body art. They're buying homes. And they're buying nice ones. One of the things we know about millennials is they are more willing to spend money on their first home than their parents were. They don't want to live in a $140,000 little F&J. They're going and buying newer, bigger homes, and they're not just buying in the urban areas, which is something a lot of us had always assumed. They're going into the suburbs because they're looking for good schools and they're looking for a sense of community. Now, the thing about millennials is this. They're not going to trade up every 3 to 5 years like most home buyers, but if you catch them on the front end, that's going to be a big purchase. Stay in touch with them. You're going to make money when they do finally trade up. But millennial volume has finally arrived. The snowflakes are becoming a positive part of our housing market. In addition to this, the apartment rent factor, I mentioned it had gone up by about 4% on average last year. They are saying it'll be about the same this year, a 4 to 5% increase. Again, more in certain areas, less in others. But pay attention to the apartments. You know, 10 years ago, if you suggested to a young agent in your office, you might try doing a seminar for people living in apartments, explain to them that they can afford homes. A lot of people would look at you and say, I don't want to waste my time with that. Well, that's fertile ground for reasons we've already discussed. But a lot of the people living in apartments already understand the value of home ownership. They're just looking for somebody who can help get them into that home. Home builders are expected to add about 32,000 new starts this year. It could be a better year than that, but the biggest issue that they face has to do with the labor issue, as we've talked about. First thing you got to talk about with builders is the price point. If you're thinking that's going to exacerbate our inventory problem or make it any better, it's not likely going to do that because the builders really aren't shooting for the entry level. Their margins are not that significant. So what they're doing is building more expensive homes and aiming at people who will spend more on their product. They're getting, for example, the Californians who are moving here. They're getting people who are downsizing but still want a home with amenities and a nice finish out. Approximately 20% of all the homes being built right now are priced at $250,000 or under. Builders are really shooting at a completely different market. And they're not able to do much more because, again, as we mentioned, the labor problem. There was a really nice article in the Dallas Morning News yesterday. You guys might want to take a look at it, talking about how labor shortages continue to frustrate builders. Even when the energy industry was floating dead and given up on, people weren't going back to work there. So until builders can find the people to put product on the ground, they're going to be hard-pressed to do much more than they do. And then inventory problems, we think they may ease slightly, but nobody's really able to give us a cogent reason why it will be significantly better next year. So what's going to happen in the year ahead? Here's what I think we can safely say. First off, higher interest rates are going to be a factor. They're going to keep some buyers on the sidelines, but you have to understand it's not going to kill the market because there are so many people moving here that have to buy a home. Higher interest rates may frustrate the trade-up buyer. You've got a $450,000 home in Twin Creeks or a lovely neighborhood here in Allen. You got in at 3 1/8 a couple years ago. So a home goes on the block a couple blocks over, it's $550,000. You're not going to be all that motivated to go pay $550 at a 5% rate if it comes to that. So a lot of people are going to stay where they are instead of trading up. But the Californians coming here, the people coming here from other states because their companies are moving here, they've got to buy homes. And they're not going to be deterred by the prospect of interest rates being a point or even two higher. Nationally, home sales should increase by about 2.2% this year. That's data taken from the venerable Lawrence Yun of the National Association of Realtors. He's their head economist. He sees an overall stronger economy and a change in economic policy as driving a slight uptake in housing purchases this year. Here in North Texas, the estimates are all over. We see people saying flat because of no inventory. We see people saying that we may have another year of 7 or 8%. The number that our companies are looking at is in that 4 to 6 range. I think it's a pretty safe bet, though, that we are going to see more transactions in 2017. Prices remain the mystery. CoreLogic is saying 4.7%, but if inventories don't get much better, we may have another year like the last two have been. We may end up with close to double-digit price appreciation. Zillow is saying 7.3%. I think bottom line, we're definitely looking at something in that 5 to 10 range, another year of price increases. It's going to be another good year. But for a lot of us, it may not feel like a great year because thanks to television, everyone in the world thinks that it's easy money to become a realtor, right? And isn't it easy money? We don't work at all in this industry, do we? But every genius out there that's watched Masters of Flip is going to get into this business in the next year, and there are going to be that many more people taking one or two away from you here or there. So it's going to be a good year. It might not feel like it for everybody. Bottom line, Mike Brody of Keller Williams Plano said last year, this is the market we've waited a lifetime for. And I don't know how much longer it lasts. I'm not here to tell you that. But I think we've got one more year, maybe two, before things start to get weird. My advice is work smart. Save your money. Don't go buy the new Mercedes this year. Have money to plow back into your business if things get weird next year. Enjoy this. Don't completely trust it. To end, I want to do one more thing. As a bit of a tip of the hat, if you will, to the gentleman who was kind of my predecessor when it came to talking about the economy and the housing market, I refer, of course, to David Fair. I will attempt to answer the question that David always answered for you. When should you take your vacation in 2017? My advice is don't take one. Because it's going to move fast and crazy, and you're going to want to be here and not miss anything. But if you do have to go on vacation, my wife says the best times to do it would be the first week of June, the second week of July, and a couple of weeks in August. We'll all be on vacation together. That being the case, I want to thank you all for giving me the opportunity to visit with you today. Thank you for suffering with me through the kind of technical mishaps. Let's go have a great year.